Hello everyone. So here we are with another type of laser system, that is a liquid laser, and generally dye lasers are considered as liquid laser. This is lecture 5th of our unit 3rd types of laser. And in the last lectures we have discussed about the solid state lasers and the gas state lasers, where we studied about the ruby laser and NDR laser under the solid state, and helium neon laser and carbon dioxide laser in case of the gaseous laser systems. And today we are discussing the liquid lasers. So before going to the working and construction of this dye laser, we should understand what is a dye. Actually, dye is a colored substance and which imparts its color when applied to any other material. So dye is basically a material when apply on another material, the material gets colored and this dye imparts its own color. And these dyes are generally organic polyatomic molecules having a very complex structure with long chains and conjugated double bonds. Using this dye as a lasing medium, Sir Sorokin and his colleagues have discovered dye lasers. Usually these dyes are considered as a lasing medium, and these dyes are dissolved in a liquid solution like water or ethanol something. So the basically the lasing medium, the active medium is the organic dye plus the solvent which we have taken to dissolve this dye, and the active centers are these organic dyes. And these dyes are highly tunable because of this dye, organic dyes, because they have a very broad emission and gain spectrum. And because of this, the tunability of this lies is very broad over a wide range of wavelengths, ranging from 320 nanometers to 200 nanometers. Here we are with the construction of dye laser, and these are the structures of few dyes like rhodamine 60, which is the most widely used and commonly used dye for dye lasers. Then we have cumarin 10 and cumarin 7. So these are the polyatomic organic materials. And as I have already talked about the lasing medium, so organic dye is dissolved in a liquid medium. And the typical concentration of dye is around 10 to the power minus 2 to 10 to the power minus 4 mole. And this organic dye plus the solvent, this is the solute, this is the solvent. So this both makes the active medium. And the active center are the organic dyes. These are a few examples of the organic dyes like rhodamine 6D, fluorescein, then stilbene, tetracene. And all these dyes emit wavelengths in different regions. And apart from this, additional chemicals have also been added in this system to prevent inter-system crossing and this prohibits the degradation of the dye. Next, we have the pumping source. Actually, in the solid state type of laser, we have optical pumping. We use optical flash lamps of krypton on xenon in the ruby laser on NDR lasers. In the gas lasers, we have electric discharge as the pumping scheme. And here in this dye laser, we usually use flash lamp and laser sources. Laser sources actually are more common to excite the ground state atoms of the dyes. And but which kind of laser system? Actually, we generally prefer CW lasers with low peak power. Actually, when we pump these dyes with a pulse laser having a very high peak power, then this dye laser will become a very high gain, high loss system that we don't need, because the upper laser level has a very has a lifetime of a few nanoseconds. So we don't need a high gain, high loss system. So we usually don't use the pulsed lasers with high peak power. we usually prefer CW lasers to excite the atoms or molecules of a dye. And for this, we usually use CW lasers with moderate peak powers, and that will be focused very tightly, concentrating its power in a small volume. And for resonators, actually general cavity is formed of two mirrors. One is a perfectly reflecting mirror and another one is a partially reflecting mirror. But in this case, one of the mirrors is replaced by a diffraction grating. What is the use of this diffraction grating? Actually, this diffraction grating is mainly used for the tunability, to bring the tunability in dye lasers. By rotating these gratings, we all know that wavelength is highly dependent on the grating. So by rotating this grating, the wavelength of a dye can be altered, and hence we call a dye laser as a tunable laser. This is simple construction of a dye laser. Here, this is the dye self. This is usually a cavity of quartz cell. Within this, we have filled some dye material, that is a dye in a solution. And this is the output mirror, which is partially reflecting. And this one is the diffraction grating to tune the wavelength. And from here, we use to shine. This is the focusing lens, focusing optics. And here is the source. So when we turn on our laser light and focused it on the dye, so here, because of this excitation laser, molecules get excited and we get lasing action because of a stimulated emission. But how this happens? For this, we need to understand the energy level diagram. So before going to energy level diagram, I would like to explain two emission processes, that is a fluorescence process and a phosphorescence process. Actually, this fluorescence process is a very rapid process. In this process, there is no time delay between the excited state the excited state atoms will come back to the ground state within no time. So they do this transition immediately. And in case of phosphorescence, the excited state atom remains there for a few seconds and then come down. So it may be millisecond or second, something like that. So both this process occurs due to the different nature of the organic dye. So whatever process is going on within the laser system depends on the nature of the organic dye. In case of fluorescence, the incoming light excites the dye molecule in the state of being ready to emit stimulated radiation, the singlet state. So in fluorescence, we have a singlet state transition. In phosphorescence, we have a triplet state transition. Let's see how. This is the energy level diagram. This is the singlet. This is the ground state denoted by S0. This is the first excited singlet state S1. This is the second excited singlet state S2. This is the triplet state, first excited triplet state and second state excited triplet state. So what is this singlet and triplet states? Actually, when an atom makes a transition from electron makes a transition from the excited state to the ground state, there are two possibilities. Number one is either an emission or an absorption. There are two possibilities. Number one, it can either flip its spin, and number two, it will preserve its spin. So if it preserves its spin, then we have half and half at both the sides. Means plus half and upper, the excited one has a plus half. And since we know that the multiplicity is defined by 2s plus 1, so S is the combination of this half and half. So we get this as one. So in the excited state, in the singlet state, there is a spin flip. So they have a lower energy. Spin flip means the one electron in the ground state with plus half, the other electron in the excited state will be in the minus half state. So there is a spin flip. So the total multiplicity will be one. If the multiplicity is one, then we called it as a singlet state. And in case of spin preservation, I mean, there is no spin flip, then plus half will make one. Then the total multiplicity 2s plus 1 is 2 plus 1 is 3. So 3 stands for triplet. So this is how we get the triplet state. So in this dye laser, the molecules in molecules of the dye, organic dye in the ground state, when they get pumped, they take the energy from the pumping source, which is the external laser source, and get excited to the first excited triplet state. And from this first excited triplet state, there are two possibilities. Number one is they make a transition, which is the intercrossing, intersystem crossing due to collision to the triplet state. And second possibility is they come down to the ground state. And this singlet states, this singlet state makes a transition from S1 to S0 within no time. And this process is the fluorescence process. And because of the intersystem crossing, mostly due to collision, when the electrons reach to the first triplet state, from this triplet state, when they make the transition to the ground state, then they also gives the laser transition. But this laser transition is the phosphorescence laser transition, phosphorescence emission. And this from the S0 to S1, this is the fluorescence emission, fluorescence laser emission. So this is how the dye laser works. If we talk about the advantages and disadvantages, then I must say that dye lasers are very flexible because we can get a very highly tunable wavelength from the dye laser. So tunability is possible with multiple means. And as I told that some additives are being added to this, so there is no degradation and no degradation of the optical properties of the dye. More robust, and these are the very compact system. They have a very broad emission spectrum. I have shown you some of the dye lasers like rhodamine, tetracene. They all having a emission spectrum in different wavelength regions. And the output that we are getting from this is available in visible as well as in non-invisible form. Beam diameter, that is the beam divergence, is and the beam divergence is very low. A very high output can be obtained with a greater efficiency of 25%. And since we have some disadvantages, and the main disadvantages are the limited lifetime. Some cases need other laser beams to excite the ground state molecules. And to tune at one frequency, the laser uses birefringent materials, elements. So sometimes it makes it more costly than the usual lasers. And it is very difficult to determine the element which actually lases, because a dye has a very complex organic structure. I have shown you it before. So they have a very complex structure, and because of this, it is very difficult to determine that which element has actually lases. Apart from such flaws, it is highly useful for astronomy purpose, for holography, pollution monitoring, in atomic physics, photochemistry, spectroscopy. And the most important uses of this dye laser is isotopic separation. We can separate the isotopes of uranium 239, 235 and other with the help of this dye laser. And in the medical field also, to remove the kidney stones in the kidneys, stone in the kidney or gallbladder, we use this laser. This laser can also be used to remove birthmarks. So these are all the applications. So in summary, this is a type of liquid laser and is a full level laser system. The active medium are the dye laser, organic dyes, which are dissolved in suitable solvents like water, methanol. And the active center here is the dye itself. The pumping scheme that we use is optical pumping, and the pumping source may be a flash lamp or generally the other low moderate power CW lasers. The optical resonator is made up of one mirror, and the another one is a diffraction grating. The output of this laser is pulsed, and the wavelength that we can get is a tunable wavelength. So this is all about dye laser. Thank you so much.